for your patience, guys. I spot Robinvale High School. Robinvale High School, would you stand, please? Can we give them a round of applause, please? Thank you very much for traveling all the way from Atlantis to join us. The rest of our participants and guests, thank you very much for joining us. We'd like to jump straight into our program today. Today is all about sharing information. And we'd like to share information that would benefit your futures, that would give you knowledge about what it is you'd possibly want to study. And so later on in the program, there will be tables of each of the departments at Cornerstone Institute with information about the courses they offer. But they will also do presentations on the content of what they have to offer in their departments. First, but at the stage of the program, I'd like to call upon the CEO, Noel Daniels, the man in charge of steering the ship Cornerstone Institute in the right direction. Noel Daniels, thank you.
Good morning everyone, and welcome to Cornerstone Institute. It's just fantastic that you could be here today. And you know you're sending out a loud message where you are saying, I care. I care. I care about my future. I care about a contribution that I could possibly make to not only make my city, my province, my country, my continent a better place, but to make the world a better place. So when you come to Cornerstone Institute, you are sending out a message, and your message is, I want to learn to change the world. So here at Cornerstone, we are very concerned about that. We are very concerned about what's happening in our neighborhoods, in our communities where we live, about our cities, about our provinces, about our countries, about our continent, about our world. And we're very concerned about you. And because we're concerned about you, we thought we would ask you to come here today. And our main mission isn't that you sign up and say that I am going to come and study at Cornerstone. That's not our main mission, although we'd like it. We really like it. We'd really like you to make a decision that this is where you want to study and complete your higher education. But what's more important for us to know and to share with you, what we want you to know, is that you have choices. So we want you to think about all the possibilities of what you can become. And nothing, nothing should stand in your way. Money shouldn't stand in your way. Motivation shouldn't stand in your way. Guidance shouldn't stand in your way. Access to quality education shouldn't stand in your way. Nothing, nothing, nothing should stand in your way. And that's our mission here this morning. We want you to get the kind of information that you will need to help you to make your own decisions about your future. And so we decided we will convene a career expo. And the Career Expo involves you putting in about 2 hours, 2.5 hours of your time this morning. Then we have another group coming in this afternoon. So if you know anybody who missed this morning and would like to come this afternoon, it starts at 1 o'clock, the next round. Then tomorrow morning again at 10 o'clock and tomorrow afternoon again at 1 o'clock. We open up our campus and we do what we're doing with you this morning, again, over and over, or three more times, that is this afternoon, tomorrow morning, and again tomorrow afternoon, for other young people and other interested people who'd like to know more about what the choices are and what opportunities an institution like Cornerstone offers. So I am very proud of you. I'm very proud that you've decided that you want to invest in your future, and you've taken the time from your school holidays to invest in getting the information that you require. So, today, I hope that you are going to have loads of fun while learning. And that is the kind of message that we also want to send. That learning does not need to be boring, doesn't need to be frustrating. It can and should be fun. So, under the very able leadership of Oscar Clutie, and I'd like you all to give him a round of applause. He's the guy who was standing here earlier. Oscar Clutie is our marketing coordinator, and he convened this event today. So Oscar will be looking after you, and I'm calling him up to come and take over, and then as he comes up, can you really give him a loud round of applause? Welcome, everybody. Have a good time.
Thank you very much, Noel. I'd like to share a little something with you guys before we continue with the program. I remember when I was in grade 10 and 11, and I walked into the student advisor's office, and she asked me the question, what do you want to become one day? And I actually thought about it, and I was like, I don't really know. I was then advised to go on Google and check, what do doctors do? What do they need to study? What do engineers do? What do they need to study? And I realized that it was so broad that in one afternoon, sitting at the PC, I couldn't decide. I then got to grade 11 and I had to make, or grade 10 and I had to make subject choices, which is needed for when you go to university to apply for certain courses, and you'll find that if you should come study at Cornerstone Institute, that there's certain admission requirements, subjects that you need to have. And that's why it was important for us to call you here today, so that you start thinking about those critical decisions that need to be made. I got to Wits University in Johannesburg, and I just decided to study a BA in international relations. Why? I don't really know. And today I find myself in a marketing space which is completely different to that. But because I didn't attend a career expo like you're doing today, maybe I could have made a decision much earlier. So feel very welcome today. Feel that you can ask the necessary questions. Later on in the program, you'll be able to go around to each department and ask those questions. That's just something I would have loved to share with you. At this stage in the program, I'd like to call up our operational manager, Philip. And what Philip's going to do is, I want you guys to feel free, relax, because now we're going to start becoming interactive. And what he's going to do, he's going to call up one or two at random, Philip. And I'd like two chairs in the front where he's going to conduct a short interview with you. As you saw in our poster, we're going to do advice and then also CV tips. So he's going to call one of you up at random to conduct a short little interview. And then he would share with you what he thinks is good interview tips and CV tips with you. Philip, you're welcome. Give Philip a round of applause. Thank you.
Good morning. So while Noel represents the more exciting part of Cornerstone, I'm part of the boring bureaucracy, something which all organizations have to have. Before we do the interview, I want you to set a scenario. Let's not make this too complicated. We want it to be a realistic interview. So what companies should we think the person is going to be interviewing for? Old Mutual, did I hear? Coca-Cola. Transnet. Old Mutual. So that's the second one for Old. So let's say Old Mutual for the first interview. Okay. What position at Old Mutual? Receptionist. Okay, let's start with the receptionist, because I think this is a sort of, it's an entry-level thing, something which we can actually relate to. All right, we have a somebody who wants to interview for a receptionist position at Old Mutual in Pinelands. It's at the head office. Who would like to... Shall I volunteer somebody, or is somebody willing to actually step up? Fantastic. Please come and join me. Please give her a hand. Good morning, Ati. Thank you very much for coming in for the interview. We had a look through your CV and you met all of the requirements, so we shortlisted you, and yeah, you are. Tell me a little bit about what you know about Old Mutual.
Okay, what I know about Old Mutual is that Old Mutual is good in planning for the future and for insuring. Yeah.
Insuring, okay. Making sure people are insured. Yeah. Excellent, thank you, thank you. Now tell me why you're attracted to this position. What draws you to it?
The fact that it deals with life insuring makes me interested.
Okay, and what part of your life relates to that? Why are you excited about that?
Because I'll be working more with people.
Okay, great. Thank you. So tell me, in terms of you, I want to know a little bit more about you. Can you give me, just in 30 seconds to 2 minutes, tell me a bit about your life?
Okay. I'm a very young, talented young lady who's willing to learn more about life, who's willing to get more education, who... is, yeah.
No, that's great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for coming in for the interview today. And we're going to interview a few more candidates, and then we will get back to you, probably within a week.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure. So a big hand for Ati. Thank you very much for coming up and participating. So going for an interview is a very nerve-wracking experience. All right. It's something which, so Ati, you know, you stepping up is actually preparing you for this that's going to take place. Because when you want to go and get a job, you're not just going to walk into that job. You're going to... go through the whole administrative side, which is filling in a CV, sending it off, and then you get the phone call, and you might have a telephonic interview first, but you go in for an interview, and most companies now will have two or three people sitting in on an interview. It doesn't matter what level that position is that you're applying for. I remember in the early 2000s, I was working in retail, and I liked my company that I worked for, but I wanted to get increases in my salary. And sometimes you actually have to go and apply for other positions simply to increase your salary, and you have a bargaining chip then. And I went for a number of interviews, and I developed techniques. And so your first interview, you're probably going to get declined for the job. Just prepare yourself mentally for that, because it doesn't mean you're not successful. It just means that you didn't get that position. And you need to take opportunities like this to interview and get these skills, so that every time you come into an interview, you perform better. So a little bit feedback, Ati. Obviously, you weren't prepared for this position, but one of the things which you're going to find in organizations is they want to know how you as a human, your character, your personality, fits the post that you're applying for. Because companies can train skills, but they can't train character. So they want to make sure that your character is a fit with the organization and a fit for this position. So that's an opportunity to sell yourself. You do your research beforehand for the organization. You must know what the company does, and you must know how this position contributes to how that company will be successful. And then you link it to how you, as a person, will actually make that happen. So if you're passionate about dealing with people, you bring it out not just by saying, you know, I love dealing with people, but you actually want to ensure that people are well off in their old age. And so you talk about how you worked with old age people in your community, and you see that they didn't do financial planning. So now I want to work for Old Mutual because I want to help people plan now while they're young for their retirement. So you link who you are as a person from your experiences to what the job is and how you're going to make a success of this for yourself as well as for the company. Okay, so we had a couple of other companies, Coca-Cola, Transnet. What should we do? Let's do another interview. Hey? Come on. Transnet. Okay, what's the position at Transnet that's going to be going?
How about
Facebook?
Facebook. That everybody uses and is familiar with.
Hmm. There's an idea. There's a job available at Facebook. Beverly, do you want to interview for a job at Facebook? Awesome. But before you come up, what position at Facebook?
I just want to talk to everybody.
Okay, the job at Facebook is ideas, guys. What do they do? Well, I remember reading one article on Facebook. There's somebody who designs just the little profile pictures. You know those gray images? The little things like that. One person does that and is continually. So there's graphic designers that work at Facebook. There are IT people who work at Facebook to enhance the platform. So which job are we applying for? There's human resources people at Facebook. Are you going to employ for human resources? No. Graphic designer. Awesome. Great. Please help me welcome Beverly Dankers. Beverly Dankers is our Director of Student Services. So welcome. Putting herself on the line here. Come in, please. Beverly, please take a seat. Thank you so much for coming in. Okay, I'm just going to get into the role for this. This is a less formal company, so. Hey, Beverly, thank you so much for coming in. Can I get you some water?
No, thank you.
All right. Beverly, thank you so much for applying for this position. Really appreciate it. I've looked through your CV.
I really want this job. I'm actually sick, but I still came for this job interview because it's very important to me.
Yes, thank you. And we appreciate that. We can see from your covering letter that you are very passionate about the work that you do and you're interested in a position like this. But tell me a bit about yourself before we just take some time to just relax a bit and we'll start asking the more formal questions. So if you can tell me about Beverly in 3 minutes, please.
I like to go on Facebook. because I can see all my friends and what they're doing and look through their pictures. And I'm single. And I studied graphic design, but I didn't finish the course. How many minutes do I have left?
No, that's enough. Thank you, Beverly. Tell me about why did you not finish the graphic design course that you finished? Because I saw, we see that you're doing work. You didn't have the qualification, but you gave some of your portfolio, and it looks good. But why did you not finish your degree?
I couldn't afford to pay for my fees, so I had to drop out. Mm-hmm. I had to go get a job. Fortunately, because I'm good at what I do, I took what I learned during the first 2 years, and the manager at the time actually thought my work was good. So, and then I also would read up a lot. I would try to educate myself. I have other friends that are graphic designers, so I just did everything I could to better what I did.
Okay, but then you are currently employed, you're enjoying what you're doing. Why do you want to leave your company?
I love the company I work for, but Facebook, I mean, the whole world knows about Facebook. To be able to work for Facebook, sure, I think I can bring some of what I have learned and perhaps bring some fresh ideas. So it's not that I don't want to be where I'm at. I just think I could perhaps progress further in life and bring to Facebook, since the whole world, we said that already, the whole world is on their phone, they're all on their phones all the time. I think I could bring something to Facebook.
Like what, Beverly?
That's a good question. You see, the profile pictures, sometimes some people put horrible pictures on. Maybe I could send them an email and say, do you want to change your picture?
But that's not exactly the role of a graphic designer, is it?
No, but you know, I just thought it could be something I could add to, you know, to make Facebook just friendlier in the way, in the pictures that are going out there.
So tell me, Beverly, how many users does Facebook currently have?
Oh, lots and lots and lots. I would think maybe a zillion or something.
And Beverly, tell me, what are the values that Facebook subscribes to?
I can tell you what I think they should subscribe to. They should be people of integrity. They should have creativity. They should have, there should be respect. I think that there should be unity amongst the staff. I think that, yeah.
Thank you very much, Beverly, for coming through for the interview. Really appreciate it. Do you have any questions that you want to ask about the organization?
Yes. When will I know if I got the job?
The interview process will continue for the next 2 days. We have a few candidates.
Oh, 2 days.
And then we will give you feedback early next week.
Thank you, Mr. Donald. Thank you very much for seeing me.
Great pleasure.
Okay. Bye.
Okay, so now I want feedback from you. Put your hand up, please, so that I can select you, but what advice would you give to Beverly? Anybody? I thought you were coming up to. Yes. Thank you. right, thorough research on the company. So knowing things like how many Facebook users would have been good if you're applying for a job at Facebook. Knowing the values of the company would be good. One of the things which I can say to you is companies don't like to be told what should be the values of a company. Yes. Yes, sit upright and present yourself in a professional manner. So when you come in for an interview, you're going to be nervous. And so how do you control your nerves before you step into an interview? Pardon? Breathe. Yep. Just breathing exercises will help you to actually just calm down and think. What else can you tell Beverly? How can you improve her chances of getting a job?
I think it's important to be fully prepared for an interview, not only to research on the company, but to hear those questions that I was actually asked somebody from voice media, that deals with interviews, a mentor, a lecturer, anybody who went there, that person just gives his best advice. So preparation will take care of the nerves, because if you're confident,
thank you very much, yes. So thorough preparation, not just research on the company, but actually going into a role play situation with somebody who's got experience to allow the person the opportunity to answer the questions they're likely to get. And if you go and do research on the internet, you say 10 questions asked in interviews. There are many sites that give tips on how to actually improve your interviewing skills and what questions you can likely get. Any other feedback? Yes? The lady behind. Not just applying for a job, as in she must show.
Desperate.
Okay. Yes. So some of the things is most people who are applying for jobs need jobs. It's not something you need to state in an interview. You've got to match why you should get this job with why the company needs somebody. Again, it's matching your skills and your character to the organization. Also, people state clearly, so I think one of the things which Beverly did well was she spoke about dropping out of university because she didn't have fees. And that is a reality faced by more than 50% of people who go and study is they'd often drop out because of that. So, but she stated it calmly and clearly. She didn't pull on a sorry act there or something like that. And so that's just a professional statement of what has happened rather than making people feel sorry for her. So, yes. Yes. But she did. She knew that she was applying for the graphic designer even though she wanted to email the users. So, yes, yeah, in the front. Were you? Eye contact with the interviewer, yes. Yes, we did get that earlier. Thank you very much. Appreciate that, yeah. Present yourself professionally. How much time do I have, Oscar? Am I done? Great. Thank you very much for participating in this. I'm going to hand back to Oscar in a minute. Just remember, prepare for your interviews, and you need to sell yourself. If this is the one thing that you take back from this, is know who you are and know what the company wants. And you've got to show the company that who you are is the best fit for this role. Thank you very much.
Let's give Philip another round of applause, please. Thank you so much, Philip. I'd like us to just stand and stretch just a little because you're going to get a lot of information. So can we just stand up and just give a good stretch. Yeah. Don't stretch too much. Don't break something. All right, guys, thank you so much for your participation in that exercise. I think it's very important to have that kind of information as you guys are going to be studying and then going into the job market and looking for your possible employment wherever you'd apply. And so those tips that were given to you is critical in finding employment. And we all know the kind of economic climate that South Africa is in and our unemployment rate and so on. So you're always competing with someone else. And so therefore you need to equip yourself with the necessary tips and skills and tools to be able to gain employment in South Africa. Let's move on to the next item on the agenda. Each department will be doing a presentation, a 5-minute presentation about their department. And I'd like to jump right into that. And first on our list would be student services. Now, student services is important because your experience on campus is very critical. And when you go to other institutions, they would also have student services where there would be assistance that's given to students, many different kinds of assistance given. But we've got a specific department for that, and they would be able to assist you when you come and join us. So the person that's going to be doing that presentation is Kanyiso. Let's give him a warm round of applause.
Morning, everyone. Morning. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
I can't hear you. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Are you happy to be here?
Yes.
It's nice to see you. I'm so excited to be here. You look wonderful, you look amazing. But I don't feel your energy, I can't feel you. I said, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I want you to repeat after me this saying. Say, if you have a desire,
if you have a desire,
do not retire
until you acquire
your desire. If you fail to aspire,
you're gonna expire.
So refire. Thank you so much. Clap, clap, just give yourself a round of applause. We are so amazing. My name is Nkanyiso Shange. I'm a student here at Cornerstone, and I'm doing B-Psych in honors. I've been here, this is my 5th year, and I'm also working for the student services. And I'm really excited to be here. I'm just going to show you, here at Cornerstone, we have a lot of fun on campus, off campus. There are so many activities happening here. So I'm just going to show you just a glimpse that in case you decide to join us next year, what is this going to experience and what vibe you're going to feel here. It's so amazing to be here. This is how we stick for a long time. So I'm just going to show you few clips and also some pictures of what is happening. Then I'm going to explain to you what our department does. So let us just watch this video. What was happening here, students, they have a nice show that they were doing. And so there's so much dance that was taking place and stuff. So just enjoy. So these are all our students.
Thank you.
Yes, this was student production. So our students, they organize this thing. We call it student development. As student services, we support these events so students, they can be more creative and do lots of things here on campus. These are the pictures. As you can see, this is campus life activities. On campus, we used to have a camp. Students, they also sing here. And also, we had like a cultural day. These are the pictures from the camp also. And we also participated in outside events. There was a Red Zebra. And yeah, we enjoy ourselves. At the beginning of the year, we had the camp. And those were the SRC. And yeah, this is the sugar ball. You see, students, they do lots of things there. And yeah, this is the dancing production. So there's lots of activities that are happening on campus. And if you're going to join us, this is part of the things that we're going to explore. I just want to show you also, we had a funny day. So in a funny day, we allow our students to go out on the park outside, and then we just do funny stuff, because education should be fun and exciting. I just want to play the video for you guys there and see what's happened on a funny day.
Running from the shadow, lost in the night. Gotta be brave and have no fear. Fighting for the fire, wait for the light. Gotta be brave, cause I need you here. In the darkness, in the darkness, I will find you. In the darkness, in the darkness, in the darkness.
Still excited. So as I told you, there's lots of fun happening here. So why do we exist as student services? So our main focus and our main reason for us to be here, we care for students, we care for education. So what we're gonna provide you is student welfare. We also provide counseling and academic support. So, and also student services, we run campus orientation. In campus orientation, what we do is we give you tips on time management. We also assist you with academic skills as you are here as a student. And we also going to help you with study skills. You need to know how to study. And we're gonna assist you to also find a meaning in your education. And you're gonna also do the campus tour. And the most important thing, we help you with Funda orientation. Funda is our site where you're gonna submit your assignment and download your readings. And as student service, as Cornerstone, you have our core values: respect, integrity, unity, inclusivity, creativity, and excellence. And the student service, we also work together with SRC. SRC means it's a student representative council. These are our wonderful and, as you can see, beautiful ladies for our SRC for 2016. But next year, we're still going to find different people. They were so amazing. They did a lot of things. And as student services, work together with them. So as you're coming in here, there's also an opportunity for you to be part of leadership of this organization. And lastly, I just wanna inspire you and encourage you as you are coming to Cornerstone that in this institution, we teach and learn in service to others to advance human dignity and social justice for all. And I really thank you to be here, and I'm really excited to see wonderful people, beautiful faces, intelligent people who are really encouraged and inspired to study. Thank you so much. Stay fun and be happy. Thank you.
How cool was that, guys? It was cool. Thank you so much, Kaniso. I noticed something, that the SRC is only ladies. Guys, how do you feel about that? Hey? I know we're very progressive, but how progressive can we be that we forget about ourselves? So come in and let's make some changes. Thank you very much, Kaniso, for that one. Student experience is important. It's not only sitting in front of your books all day, but your experience on campus is also important, which should make you want to come back the next day, want to wake up at 6 in the morning to come to campus. So that's very important. Thank you so much. The next presentation will be from sociology and community development, and they're going to be talking through, let me not go into their details, they'll be able to deal with that. But going to be doing the presentation will be Claire and Luvuyo. Let's give them a round of applause.
You do that for me. Morning. How are you guys? I'm screaming purposely. Morning.
Morning.
Are you guys excited? Can you please stand up, please? We're about having fun here at Cornerstone, right? Let's just have fun just for a minute. Okay, guys, follow me, eh? Can you do this? Once. Guys, listening is a skill, eh? Let's do this. Okay. I'll say now clap, and if I didn't, you mustn't clap. Just clap once, twice, thrice, once, twice, once. Okay, do this. Follow me like this. Okay, guys. May I have a seat? Guys, it's always good to have fun. Yes, at Cornerstone, you know, we're not only about fun, we study, that's where our life, gets changed. But my job here is just simple, we are representing the Department of Sociology and Community Development. At some stage in my life, not so long ago, you can see, guys, I'm still young, eh? And I'm short. I'm proud of that. So, not so long ago, I used to ask myself, what is it that I will be when I grow up? Grow up, not grow tall. So, I've made peace with that I won't grow tall anyway. So, those are the questions that I more often ask myself as to what is it that I will be when I grow up. I know, not every one of you perhaps still ask themselves that question, because others maybe have already chosen whatsoever that they will do. But some, they are where I used to be. So, but having grown up where I grew up, I decided to say, I want to change myself. I want to change the status of my family. I want to change my community. Who in this room wants to change their lives? And I don't need an answer, but I just need your hand to say, I will say that's me. Guys, it seems as if you are not sure. Let's not copy here. Don't look at your friend and then, okay, their hands is up or not. Who wants to change their lives? Okay, who wants to change their family? Change means change their economic status anyway. Changing to bring, a positive change in their family. Who wants to change their community? Therefore, you are at a right place, at a right time, because at Cornerstone, we offer exciting programs in sociology and community development. But I know at a matric level, or where you are, guys, perhaps you don't even know what is sociology and what is community development, what is it that is all about. Why do we have to study those things? Because sociology offers us, makes us to be able to be creative, to think critically, to ask questions that sometimes many people, they feel or they don't wanna ask. So, and also to bring about change in our communities. So, it's mostly fascinated by people. If you like to work with people, not just at an individual level, but at a community level, to understand as to what is it that you can do in your community. So it also offers you, like the truth is, despite of every field that you are in or whatsoever, a course that you're gonna change, that you're gonna choose, the truth is labor market is changing constantly. Every year, innovative things, and it's more technologically, you know, orientated because technology exists, you know. So courses in sociology and community development, they offer you that critical skills to think critically, creatively, and also your writing skills also improve, and also your speaking abilities. Let me just put it like that. So it is important that you see, like, as we are so diverse in like either the world is becoming globalized, you need to be able to, you know, to learn these things. But you can work in various fields, like in education, in NGOs. We all know what NGOs are. You can work in government, you can work in parastatals. So it's a very, or courses in sociology and community development, they offer you that variety to be able to work anywhere you want to work. So I won't continue much. I will give you a chance, Claire, to continue.
Thanks, Lavoya. I think what Lavoya said is important, because certainly I didn't know that sociology even existed before I went to university. And once you start asking yourself about what it is that you want to do, you realize, well, maybe there are options out there that I didn't know existed before. So the thing with sociology, and I think what is different about sociology to psychology, which we understand, we all kind of know what psychology is, right? But the difference is that what we look at is that we look at the bigger picture. We look at, okay, what is this relationship between myself as an individual and the larger society? What are the social structures that influence our lives? And therefore, what are the ways in which we can intervene in those social structures? When we think about something like youth development, it's not just about working with individuals, it's about working with groups of people, about working with a whole community. So if you're thinking about that's where you want to influence the world, then sociology and community development is the place for you. So what do we offer here at Cornerstone in that regard? Just by the way, I love this picture, because there is something about depression which we think is purely about ourselves as individuals, but actually the context that we're in really influences how it is that we respond to the world. So these are the kinds of questions that we ask. These are the kinds of answers we look for. They're big picture answers. So at Cornerstone, we offer an undergraduate degree, a BA in sociology and community development. And you can choose either to focus on sociology or you can focus on community development. And what we do in this, in over the 3 years, is that we develop an in-depth understanding of the theory. There's lots of theory. And even though you think it's boring, it's actually not. It's very interesting. Well, I think so anyway. And Lavoya will tell you it's very interesting, right? Okay. So we critically engage issues like poverty reduction. What is poverty? Why do we have poverty? Where does it come from? And therefore, what is it that we can do about it? We think about conflict. Why does conflict arise in society? Right? We think about globalization. What is the relationship between what's going on in the rest of the world, economically and socially, to what's happening in our own communities? We think about social differences, things like race and gender, all of these things that are so difficult that we struggle with, particularly in South Africa. And what's important about our program is that we have a strong South African, African focus. We're thinking about our problems and what we can do about our problems here. Also very important for us is that it's not just about theory, and that in the undergraduate program, you have an opportunity for practical real life experience. In your third year, you do a fieldwork placement whereby you go into a community, you work on a project, and you do research in that particular area. We're very, very, it's very, very important for us that the theory that we look at is very integrated with practice. So by the time you leave, you have some practical experience. You don't just have a head full of theory, which is very important. The undergraduate degree you can do here at Cornerstone, or you can do it online. So if you can't come to campus, there is an online opportunity, and it will take you a minimum of 3 years. Just with regards, I'm sure I'm out of time, Oscar. 1 minute. Can I keep going? Okay, great. What do you need in order to be able to get onto the undergraduate program, right? It's the same as you would need for any of our undergraduate programs. You need a national certificate with a bachelor's pass, okay? Or an equivalent. You could have a matric certificate. You could have a higher certificate. Right? So there are lots of ways of getting into the program. And even if you don't make these criteria, we have alternative routes of admission. So we will consider your application. Right? But that doesn't mean you shouldn't be studying very hard for your matric. You should be, so that you can get that bachelor's pass, because that's the best, that's the easiest, that's your way in. Okay. To let you also know that it doesn't stop at undergraduate, that if you choose, if you find that you really, really love this work, like I found I really, really love this work and I wanted to study more, then we have the opportunity of moving on to the honors level where you can actually deepen your theoretical knowledge and your practical experience in the field. So we offer an honors degree as well. And you can find out more about that. So you can find out more about all of these, or everything we've talked about, the content, the admission, anything you'd like. Lavuyo and I will be at the back table there with one of the tablecloths. We have sweets. They're free. Come and get them. And I just want to leave you with this thought, and it's a one, I mean, for me, it's a very powerful thought, is this thought that never doubt that a small group of concerned citizens can change the world. And in fact, it's the only thing that ever does. So that if we are committed to something, that we can actually achieve it. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I forgot to introduce Claire. She's the HOD. She's the head of the Department of Sociology and Community Development. Well done, Claire. Let's give her a round of applause. Thanks. Can I ask quickly, among us that we have here, who's interested in business or owning maybe a small business one day? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to ask it again. Who's interested in owning a small business or even a big multinational company one day? Okay. This good man walking up to the front, look at him. Doesn't he look like a businessman? Does he? Yeah, he does. Okay, he's going to be discussing, he's from the business department called Feet. He's going to explain. And I'm going to hand over to him so he gives you more information. Let's give Tulani a warm round of applause.
Thanks. Hello. Hello.
Hi.
That makes more sense.
My name is Tolani Dube. I project coordinate the business studies course. I don't have sweets like the last crew had, but I'll be at that table there, and I'll be issuing vouchers for the sweets at that table there. Just so you know, so that's your first stop. I think what's the beauty of this department is the youngest department at Cornerstone. We're about 3.5 years old. So we currently have the certificate only on offer, but she'll be getting our BCom next year. And with that slide, when I say business is everything and everything is business, I think a lot of people get a bit uneasy with that and don't understand it. But we're living in a world that's becoming very innovative, and we're living in a world where unemployment is rising. And the whole idea now is to have to have youngsters who can be entrepreneurs. So that's how the faculty was birthed. So it's the Faculty of Entrepreneurship and Economic Transformation, because as a country, we're moving into a period where transformation is necessary. And my view is the transformation needs to be a case where South Africans own South African businesses, where South Africans are able to build up South African businesses. And generally, where Africans, whether you're black, white, yellow, green, are able to build a sustainable business anywhere on the African continent and beyond. As I said, we currently offer just a certificate in business studies and business leadership. It's the same thing, but it only means that if you're taking it online, which is an option, it's called a leadership course, and you're taking it on campus. It's studies. It's a requirement by the Council on Higher Education. But ultimately, you have the same certificate. And the idea of it when it was birthed was originally have it offered to older students who are in different fields. Like you'll find engineers, you'll find people in the plumbing division who can run a business, who know the basics of that particular business, but don't understand the business side of it, which is why a lot of businesses fail, which is why a lot of NGOs fail, because they understand the principles of an NGO, but not the principles of a business. So the idea was to offer it to mature students. But like I said, because of what's happening in the economy, it becomes something where I think the young students can take a hold of it, and we can create an entrepreneurial spirit whereby we're saying, this is my view, we were saying we need to create more youngsters who have a Silicon Valley mentality, where you're stepping out to say, how can I start up something? Instead of, I need to finish and get employed, which is unfortunately the current reality. We don't have that much startups because we're not thinking in that mindset. So this is basically what we've done with it. And like I said, the whole idea of it was to help people understand the market environment and its changes, because it's changing, and to understand people in your organization, because as you run a business, you're not only faced with issues of, the environment becomes very large. You're not only faced with issues of just the environment outside, you have an environment within. So you need to understand that, how to deal with people's personalities, how to manage people. So we've incorporated all that into our modules. We've also we have a special module called the business plan, which basically outlines you writing a viable business plan and presenting it. So, you know, at the end of it, once you submit that, if we're comfortable saying, look, this is a good response from you, you can take it either to NEF, to IDC, So that's the whole idea. We were saying the certificate aims at creating that kind of mindset. The way forward for the department, like I said, hopefully next year we'll be offering a BCom, which means there is a you can continue in that direction. The requirements remain the same as with every other certificate. What people will notice is you need a matric pass, and the certificate allows those who have a matric pass to do it but don't have a bachelor's pass. So for me, I think it's not really the issue of whether you have this kind of pass or that kind of pass. I think you have to have a mindset of saying, this is something I need to take on to help me grow something I'm going to build going forth. So like I said, I'll be seeing you over there to collect the vouchers for the suites to go over there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tulani. I forgot to put up my hand as well when I asked who's interested in having a small business or a business one day. I'm one of them. So I'm even thinking about doing that course myself. Who's interested in teaching? Anybody interested in teaching? Yes. I'm going to hand over to Peter. Peter is the head of the Department of Education. Okay, sure. Grab over, sure.
Give Peter a round of applause.
Right, let's do one, two little exercises. First of all, I want you to give me a round of applause. Right. And the second thing I want you to do is to give a silent cheer. One, two, three. Right. Round of applause and a silent cheer. Okay. Who remembers or who can tell me why yesterday was such a significant day in education throughout the whole world? It was World Teacher Day. And because it was World Teacher Day, and because teaching is regarded as the mother of all professions, I think. And come on, you wouldn't be sitting here if you didn't have teachers. A round of applause. And I also need a silent.
Okay. Right, I've got to use the mic, so I can't use my hands now either. Let me just tell you a little bit about the PGCE, a postgraduate certificate in education. This is the one of two ways in which you can become a teacher in South Africa at the moment. All right, it's a postgraduate qualification, so you have to have a three-year degree or a national diploma before you can become take on this certificate of education. So the news is that I probably won't see you next year at all, or at least for the next 3 years, but I am hoping to see you in 3 years' time once you've got your degree, and then you decide, right, I want to become a teacher, so you then come and enroll with the PGCE. Right, and the course is presented online. It's a part-time course, and it goes over 2 years. At this stage, we only have an intermediate phase, PGCE, although there are other teaching qualifications that we're also trying to present as well. And then also I just want to say that the PGCE is a very exciting course to have. It's you work on your own, you work with other people as well. It's one of those programs where you can have a tremendous effect on other people. And you can have a tremendous effect on the lives of children for generations to come. Come on, all of us remember something that our primary school teacher told us or said to us or did or whatever, all right? And that's the sort of effect you can have on children as well. And also in terms of community building, that also brings it in there too. So I just want to say to you that if you want to find out more information about the PGCE, I'm sitting at that table over there, the last one. You're more than welcome to come there and come and ask questions, and we'll try and answer for you as well. Right, I want to say thank you, everybody.
Can you guys see how enthusiastic people are, young and not so young? There's energy, there's excitement, there's fun at Cornerstone Institute. Thank you very much, Peter. Up next, we have theology. Now, what is our understanding about theology? Is it just that you study theology to become a pastor, to become a minister in a church? Is it to what? Sometimes I also don't know the answer, but the person that does have the answer, though, is the HOD of theology. Richard, you can come up. Give Richard a round of applause.
So when you study theology, you never just study theology. Theology is always about what's happening in the rest of the world and what's happening outside of the field. So at Cornerstone, when you're studying theology, you've got the option of you can do it within a BA, or you can do it within a Bachelor of Theology or a certificate. With all of those, you have the option there of doing theology together with counseling, together with community development. And so when you graduate, you're not just a person who studied theology, you're also able to carry on with psychology studies or carry on with community development studies. And so our graduates who studied theology at Cornerstone, a lot of them are working outside of just the church ministry. The skills that they'll be learning, let me try this thing, sweet. So we obviously teach theology and we teach biblical studies. You're also going to learn conflict resolution. You're going to learn about peace and peace studies. You'll learn leadership. You'll learn to care for people. You'll learn public speaking. We call it homiletics. It's just a fancy name for preaching. You learn to understand God and God's action in the world. And what you should be learning as you're studying theology, especially together with psychology or sociology, maybe we find a way for you to sneak in some business studies as well. As you're doing that, what you should be learning is where you fit into the world and what it is that you are called to do and the difference that you are called to make in the world. In general, we find a lot of graduates don't end up working in fields, in the exact field that they studied. So studying here, you're being prepared to work in a church, you're being prepared to work in other places. But more than that, you're being prepared as a person to fulfill a meaningful role and to have purpose in society. So moving on from there, what I'm going to do is just go through a very brief snapshot of some of the places where our graduates are working. Some of these graduates are graduates who've done theology and other subjects as well. So some of them have done psychology and gone on to be psychologists. Some of them have done sociology and leadership, and so there's a huge range here. We start there, people in church ministry, so there's pastors. Pastor Jubilee Community Church, children's pastor and communications manager at Somerset West United. Harvest Church, we got teen ministry at Christ Church Kenilworth, outreach coordinators, we got a pastor in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, an associate rector in the Anglican Church of Southern Africa, and we got elders at Common Ground Church. So it's a huge range of churches that people have come through Cornerstone and are working in. Outside of church life, but still within what we believe to be God's kingdom and God's work, got people working as, we've got directs of bottom-up social development, independent development consultants, team members at the Warehouse. If you've heard of the Warehouse, it's an awesome, awesome NGO doing awesome work. Director of Scripture Union in the Western Cape is a Cornerstone graduate. People working in Mitchell's Plain School of Skills, Common Good Foundation, and links to Artscape Theatre. Coming through and studying theology and other things at Cornerstone, we have people who've gone on to work in administrative roles at Cape Mental Health, to work in Lentegier Psychiatric Hospital, New Tech, so human resources, So HR generalist, I don't know what they mean by that. But also senior social worker at Crystal House, South Africa. Getting close to the end here. A whole bunch of school teachers have come through studying theology and other things at Cornerstone. See, a bunch of schools that our graduates are at. In higher education, there are a bunch of Cornerstone graduates like myself who are working at Cornerstone. Got people at Stellenbosch, people at South African College of Applied Psychology. We've got someone at Azusa Pacific University. One of our graduates is working on the Council of Higher Education. They are one of the people who make sure that we are doing what we're supposed to be doing, as well as student services at Cornerstone and at other institutions. And then just beyond education, again, this is a snapshot. So there are a whole bunch of graduates who've come through Cornerstone who are working in all sorts of other work. But we got a facility manager, we got a doctor in Queensland. That's a medical doctor, not a theology doctor. Got general managers at Giraffe. Giraffe is a restaurant in London. Personal finance, people working in gymnastics. General manager there at Giraffe, that comes up twice, I'm sorry. And working at the Office of the Public Service Commission and Departments of Social Development. And so that's in government. So hopefully what you're seeing from this is, as these students have learned to find their place in the world, figured out who they are and the role that they can play, they've found meaningful work that they can do. That is what we are about, to find, well, what is your place in God's creation and God's world? If that's what you're interested in, then come study theology with us, and we can put you in together with psychology and sociology as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jy's lank, jy. Thank you very much, Richard. It's interesting how many different things you're able to... I can't see people now, the lights are dark. Right, thank you. Interesting to see how many different things you can do with theology and what you can achieve and so on. And this brings us to our next speaker. And psychology, I find that many people are interested in psychology. Very complex area of study, lots of different things within psychology there's that you can focus on, and so Narissa from the psychology department will come up and do. This is the last presentation, guys, just so you can like breathe. Let's give Narissa a chance to share with us. Give us a round of applause.
The best for last. Okay, no doubts about that. You hear everybody mentioning psychology, psychology, psychology. So it's connected to the other departments as well. So you need to really listen carefully. I see some people are sitting with their arms crossed, legs crossed, eyebrows crossed. Don't be cross, man. Just uncross. We'll try a simple exercise. If your arms are crossed, or if they're not crossed, cross them quickly. See, it just went into that naturally, right? Now I want you to consciously cross them the other way. How does that feel? Feels weird, it's uncomfortable, okay? So now I'm gonna ask my next question. What is psychology? What do you think psychology is about? But? It's all in the mind, okay? Something to do with the mind. What else? So long, long, long ago, in 1987, when I matriculated, where were you in 1987? Okay, various places. And I told my family I wanted to study psychology. They said, what? What psychology? It's so difficult. It's so weird, okay? You guys are in a very different and a very fortunate space today where it's being referred to more frequently, it's been written about in magazines, and of course we're going to be available at the back as well to ask you more questions. to answer some of your questions. So basically, it's a scientific study of behavior, like why do we always do this? Or why, if I did this, what will you do? Yeah, and then if I do that? Body language, signs, so understanding these things. So the goals of psychology, as you can see there, to describe how people behave, to understand the causes of these behavior, and apply psychological knowledge in ways that enhance human welfare. And it is supposed to move. So, quick question. What do you see? Who sees two faces? Who sees a candle stand? If you see the candle stand and you look again, can you actually see the faces? You see what makes our lectures so interesting, okay? And I'll tell you a bit more about our programs now. So we offer then the Bachelor of Arts, where you can major in psychology, and you can do this through contact lectures, coming in, being with us, or you can do it online. Then within the Bachelor of Theology program that Richard referred to, there is a psychology major. Of course, once you've graduated, you can decide to do an honors in psychology. And we're very excited about our BA honors in the B-Psych equivalent program. This leads up to your registration as a registered counselor with the Health Professions Council of South Africa. And currently, I'm very proud to say that we're the only place in the Western Cape offering this training. So it's very, very exciting. And then we've got the higher certificate in community counseling, and on our agenda is to get into a master's program as well. Okay. So, you'd need a grade 12 bachelor's pass, and there are your various options there. In order to get into the honors program, you need at least a minimum of 65% in your undergraduate. But everyone that you've heard from has laid the foundation. So there's lots of help, there's lots of support available at Cornerstone to help you through that. You could, from studying psychology, enter any of these categories. You could become a registered counselor with an honors level. You could work in psychometrics. You could become a clinical psychologist like myself. You could be a counseling psychologist, educational, industrial, forensic. Those of you who like to watch CSI and all those other programs, yeah. But there's a lot more, okay? So don't just think with a BA you then go on to CSI. TV is very different from reality. Very different. Okay. We hope that by the time you leave here, you will leave with the following skills: interpersonal communication, information gathering and reporting, problem identification, project management, methodological skills. We have very, very good lectures in our research and methodology modules. Presentation and workshopping skills we are very big into, because we want to prepare you to leave from here and go into an occupation somewhere, into a job, to be able to work and earn some money, right? Yeah, okay. So critical thinking and reading is important. And then links there with what Peter told you about the PGCE, so you can do your BA, go on to become a teacher as well. So you can see all the connections. Where could you eventually work? Private practice? The economy being as it is, not always the way to go, okay? Because if you had to choose between sending your child for therapy and buying food for your family, can you see how the economy plays a part? How sociology plays a part? So we would want to ideally expose you to everything else, and I'm telling you this now so that you'll see why we train our students the way we do at Cornerstone, so that you could go into academia, you could go into working in psychoeducation or as a school counselor. Community-based work, we have lots of people who go into working at NGOs, government, corporate, and then interdisciplinary work. So, that leads me to how we teach in our course. We have a strong focus on both psychological theory and practical skills. So we don't just give you the book and leave it there. We want you to apply it, and we want to feel confident that you are confident in your application. So we have a lot of class interaction, engagement, and experiential activities. Group presentations are always included, particularly at the third year level. And field work and interviews are done by our students. We've got Tashrik from Nedoman here. And you had four students at your school, right? And they were our third year psychology students who we placed there to do a field work placement. So they worked there for 6 months, one day a week, and we guided them through the process, and they wrote a brilliant report at the end of it. And we hope to engage in more of these relationships within the community. So at the same time, we're serving our communities. We then visit organizations. We have lots of guest speakers coming in, international and national. Counseling, family studies, and psychology modules are taught. And what distinguishes us from, I think, the bigger universities, because you say, oh, well, I can study psychology anywhere, is that here we have smaller classes, which allows us to work developmentally with our students. So you have a glimpse at our department there. Geraldine Franciscans is our head of department. We've got Dr. Sarani Symington, one of our senior lecturers, Natalie, who's in the research field. You might recognize this other lady there. And then Dr. Sharon was around. She's also lecturing here. Nick is an alumni of Cornerstone and now one of our lecturers. And we've got Celeste, also an alumni of Cornerstone. So, and then we have various other part-time and ad hoc people coming in. So, in conclusion, you can see there something that Carl Jung, and you will get to know more about him when you study psychology, something that he said, your vision will become clear only when you look into your heart. Your vision will become clear when you look into your heart. Who looks outside? Dreams. He looks inside, awakens. So if you're ready to awaken, see me at the back, bring all your questions, and keep calm, study psychology.
That was cool. Guys, we've come to the end of the presentations from each department. Each department will now be allocating someone to their table where we will have until about 12 o'clock to go around to each department table, ask them the necessary questions. They've got brochures for you of their courses and information at their tables. And then what we're going to do is, we've got two beautiful young people. Tamsin and Zunaid, would you come forward quickly, please? They're going to be your tour guides for the day. And so I see we're a bit of a big group. So one group will go with the one. This is Tamsin, and that is Zunaid. Hello, Zunaid. Hi, Tamsin. Okay.